The dot product, level 8. In this video, we will go over our first application that makes use of the dot product. Recall that we covered two different forms of the dot product, the component definition and geometric definition. Having these two forms of the dot product opens the possibility of using basic algebraic operations, like in the case of the component definition, to calculate geometric quantities like lengths and angles via the geometric definition. In the previous video, we used this to our advantage to find the angle between two vectors by rearranging the geometric definition. Another useful application of the dot product is to find the scalar and vector projections between two vectors. Many applications in physics and engineering make use of vectors by adding two or more vectors to produce a resultant vector. At times, the reverse problem, in this case, decomposing a given vector into the sum of two or more vector components, is often encountered. Given two vectors, A and B, with the same initial point and theta representing the angle between vector A and vector B, the scalar projection of B onto A, also called the component of vector B along vector A, is defined to be the magnitude of the vector projection. You can think of the scalar projection of vector B onto vector A as the length of the shadow that is cast when you shine a light in the direction perpendicular or orthogonal to the line that is parallel to vector A. Using right triangle trigonometry, we see that the scalar projection is going to be equal to the magnitude of vector B times cosine of theta. We mathematically denote this length as follows, and is read as the component of B along A. Similar to the dot product, this value will be positive if theta is between 0 inclusive and pi over 2 exclusive. And it will be negative if theta is between pi over 2 exclusive and pi inclusive. Notice that this quantity appears in the geometric definition of the dot product. Using this expression, we see that the dot product between vector A and vector B can be interpreted as the length of vector A times the scalar projection of vector B onto vector A. The geometric definition of the dot product can also be used to provide a simple way of calculating the scalar projection of one vector in the direction of another vector. We know that the value of the scalar projection is just equal to the magnitude of vector B times cosine of theta. So we go ahead and solve for this quantity. Doing that, we obtain the following expression. Notice that the component of vector B along vector A can be computed by taking the dot product of vector B with a unit vector in the direction of vector A. In other words, if you want to find out how much a vector V leans in the direction of a given vector, you simply dot vector V with a unit vector that points in the direction of the given vector. The scalar projection is nothing new. We have already computed this quantity various times when we broke apart a vector in R squared into its x and y components, and a vector in R cubed when we broke it apart into its x, y, and z components. In these cases, we found the scalar projection of the vector in the direction of the unit standard vectors I hat, j hat, in the case of R squared, and I hat, j hat, and k hat in the case of R cubed. What makes a dot product so useful is the fact that you can now easily calculate the component of a vector in any direction, and not just the standard unit vectors I, j, and k. The ability to decompose a vector into its component parts is a fundamental theme in physics, engineering, and linear algebra. We will see this in action in a later video. The vector projection of vector B onto vector A, also known as the vector component of vector B along vector A, can be computed by multiplying the scalar projection of vector B onto vector A with the unit vector in the direction of vector A. The vector projection would generate a vector that points in the direction of the vector that it was projected onto, with the length of the shadow casted representing the scalar projection. So keep this detail in mind. The scalar projection will generate a scalar that represents the length of the shadow that is created when one vector is projected onto another vector, while the vector projection will generate a vector whose magnitude is equal to the length of the casted shadow. In the special case where vector A is a unit vector, this expression simplifies to the following. Personally, I like to use the first form since it makes more sense intuitively than the second expression, but you're free to use either one. They are essentially equivalent expressions. One last thing to note is that we need to be very careful with our notation. The vector projection of vector B onto vector A will generate a totally different vector when compared to the vector projection of vector A onto vector B, assuming that both vector A and vector B are distinct vectors. In the first expression, the vector generated will be parallel to vector A, while in the second expression, the vector generated will be parallel to vector B. So be careful with the notation, and make sure you double-check that you're finding the correct vector projection. The final projection that you should be familiar with is the vector component of vector B orthogonal to vector A. This vector is denoted as follows. This is referred to as the orthogonal projection of vector B onto vector A. It is also known as the vector rejection of vector B from vector A. This vector is the orthogonal projection of vector B onto a line that is orthogonal to vector A. Both the vector projection and vector rejection represent the components of vector B. As a result, the sum of the vector rejection and vector projection is equal to vector B. If we solve for the orthogonal projection of vector B onto vector A, it will be equal to vector B minus the vector projection of vector B onto vector A. Also notice that the vector projection and vector rejection are orthogonal to one another. With these two projections, you can essentially break apart a vector into two components that do not point in the direction of the standard unit vectors I, J, and K. So now you're free to break a vector into components along any vector. Alright, in our next video, we will go over a couple of examples to illustrate how to find these projections.